You are assigned to be a part of the change. I believe those who don't have the gift of the Holy Spirit, keep coming. It's gonna fall on you. Just ask Him to have His way in your life. God, I receive your spirit. God, I want more of you. I want your spirit. I need the power of the Holy Ghost so that I can live right, so that I can talk right, so I can think right, so I can pray right, so that you can unlock some things when I read your word, so that I can hear your voice more clearly. I need your Holy Spirit to rest, rule, and abide in me now and forever. That is our prayer, God, to have your way. If you want God to have his way in you, I dare every one of you in this house today and worship him in the way that you worship. This ain't about standing, it ain't about sitting, but it's about a heart condition. I challenge you to sing this worship along with us for God to have his way in your life. I don't know what that is. I don't know what it is that you need God to have his way in. But whatever that thing is, get it in your mind right now. Because when we sing this next round of Have Your Way, we are singing it with intention. We are singing it believing that God is going to do that very thing. Whatever that thing is, even if it's just for God to speak a word through the man of God that would be life-changing, life-altering. God, I need to hear from you. We need God to have his way in this place, amen? Anybody ready to serve this morning? I mean, really ready to serve and worship. To really serve. Because some folk do come to just receive, because some folks showed up weak. And that's all right. That's what we're here for. So I need y'all to go for yourselves and for your neighbor. Y'all ready? I said, are you 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 ready? Come on, everybody, say, have your, have your.
If you will, to the book of Luke, chapter number 24. Luke chapter number 24. I'm going to pick up, I believe, where we left off last week. Luke chapter number 24. Luke chapter number 24. And I want to begin reading, if I can. I'll read the whole context. I'm going to start at verse number... verse number 44 again, Luke 24, verse number 44. Again, if you have it, say amen. The word of God says as follows. He said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the psalm." Then he opened their minds that they could understand the scriptures. He told them, "This is what is written: the Messiah will suffer and will rise from the dead, and on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses to these things." Here's the text, verse number 49. "I am going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." Verse 50 says, "When he had led them out to the vicinity of Bethany, he lifted up his hands and blessed them. While he was blessing them, he left them and was taken into heaven. Then they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy. And they stayed continually at the temple, praising God." Let's pray together. Father, in Jesus' name, we're grateful and we're thankful today for all things. Thank you for what you've done, for who you've been to us. You've been faithful. You've watched over your word to perform it. We can find no fault in you. It is our prayer now, Father, that you would let revelation knowledge flow, that you would share your heart and reveal your mind. In any way you bless us, we'll be satisfied. I ask, God, that you would grant me an anointing to teach and your people to learn. Grant me an anointing to preach and your people to hear. Grant us all an anointing to hear, understand, receive, and apply what your word instructs. Show yourself to be mighty in this place. In Jesus' name we pray and we boldly declare the devil's defeated. Yes, God, you are exalted. And Jesus, you are Lord. And all who agree with the prayer of the man of God shout out hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. And thank you, Jesus. Before you're seated, verse number 49 says, "I am going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you've been clothed with power from on high." King James and New King James say, instead of stay, they say wait. Tell your neighbor beside you, just wait. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Just wait. Thank you. Good morning, family. My brothers and my sisters, one of the things that is obvious about the life and ministry of Jesus is the fact that he was keenly aware of two things. Number one, when you examine Jesus's life, it is obvious that he was keenly aware of his divine purpose. Somebody shout purpose. Purpose. Number two, when you examine the life of Jesus, you will see that he was keenly aware of the importance of being in sync with divine timing. Somebody shout divine timing. Mama Glenn, I know I'm right about it, because all throughout the gospel narratives, Jesus proves this very point by using a phrase that is familiar, I'm sure, to many of us who have read the Word of God. The phrase is this: "My time is not yet." When you see Jesus's life, Mother Clark, Mother Killings, Mother Greer, when you see Mother Liz, Mother Jones, Mother Lynn, when you see the life, Mother Adams, of Jesus within this context, you will understand that Jesus timed elements of his ministry carefully, though people often seem to challenge his timing. For example, number one, you remember early in Jesus's ministry, his mother Mary had requested that he perform a miracle at a wedding that his cousin had in Cana of Galilee. And the Bible lets us know that Jesus, watch this, did not immediately move on his mother's request. But when his mother said to him, "Son, the wine has run out," he asked her, "Woman, what have I to do with that? Because my time has not yet come." he said that, and when he says, my time has not yet come, it indicated that he was working on a divine schedule and that he was managing the pace at which people would be confronted with the reality of who he was. So that when Mary suggested that Jesus do something at the wedding, watch this, Elder Greer, she likely wanted a more public miracle that everyone could see and glory in. But Jesus knew that it was not his time. And because he knew it was not his time, Jesus did not do that miracle publicly, so to speak. He did it discreetly, and only a select group of people saw it. There was another time when Jesus was challenged, Elder Tao, challenged, Elder Colbert, challenged to move outside of the timing of God. You remember, it came close to the end of his journey, and his brothers said to him, why don't you go up to the feast of the Passover and show yourself openly, because no one does what you do to do it in secret. Jesus says to them, y'all go up there. Y'all can go freely. Y'all can move whenever you want to. But I can't go freely because my time is not yet. I needed to say all of this to you, my brothers. I needed to say all of this to you, my sister, because we need to understand that when you consider this whole concept of purpose, and when you consider this whole concept of timing, we must understand that it is possible to know that there is a challenge and a conflict when it comes to divine purpose and divine timing. Here's what I mean. You can know what your purpose is and yet enter into your purpose prematurely. Let me say that again. You can know what purpose is. You can see what God wants to do in your life. You can have a firm grasp, and you can know beyond the shadow of a doubt that it's God, and it's God who has assigned it for your life. But if it is not time to move into it, if it is not time to express it, it is not time to go for it, then you do more harm than you do good. Somebody ought to shout, yes, Lord, in here. My brothers and my sisters, there is much to be said for wisdom in waiting. I have found that oftentimes waiting is the difference between regret and reward, succeeding and sadly failing. Oftentimes, to see purpose, to know purpose, but to move prematurely in purpose sets us up for major failure. Talk, Kevin Long, I think I will. My brothers and my sisters, you see it over and over and over again. And you've heard me say this, that just because it is a clear view, it does not mean that it is a short leap. Because you can see it clearly does not mean you can get there quickly. That's why the Bible tells us things about waiting. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength, mount up on wings as eagles, run and not be weary, walk and not faint. We shout about it, but the key is in the waiting. If you don't wait, you don't renew your strength. If you don't wait, you don't mount up on wings as eagles. If you don't wait, you can't run and not be weary. If you don't wait, you can't walk and not faint. The Bible tells us in another instance, wait on the Lord and be of good courage, and he will strengthen your heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. Are y'all catching what I'm saying? Yeah, you can wait on, if you don't wait on him, there ain't no courage. If you don't wait on him, there's no strength. If you don't wait on him, there is no testimony. Oftentimes, watch this, knowing what purpose is but not knowing the timing of the manifestation of purpose will put us out there, and we get out too far and can't get back. My brothers and my sisters, I want you to look at the text, because the disciples have seen proof positive of the master's resurrection. They had seen what he'd been through. We talked about that last week. They saw him being beaten. They saw him being persecuted. They saw him being prosecuted. They saw him nailed to the cross. They saw him take his last breath. They saw them peel his body off of the cross. They saw them throw his body into Joseph of Arimathea's tomb. They saw, though, also the open or the empty tomb. And it was upon that revelation that Jesus starts appearing to them and showing them himself. The Bible says that when he appears to them, he appears first, he appears first to Cleophas and the other disciple. Then he appears to the 11 after they had heard the testimony of Jesus' resurrection. And when he shows up in the room, the Bible says that he shows them, watch this, that number one, he had been wounded, but he was still alive. You remember, he showed them his wounds. That's what the text says. The text says in verse number 38, don't be troubled, don't doubt, because my hands and my feet are proof, watch this, that I went through it, but I came out of it. He says, touch me and see, because a ghost does not have flesh and bones. He shows them his wounds, but he also proves to them that what he had been through did not break him. Remember what he said, not only will I allow you to touch me, but give me a piece of fish. Let me eat. Let me show you that what I went through did not break me. Let me show you that what I went through did not stop me from engaging in fellowship with the people that I love. I'm preaching to somebody in here today, because God is saying to you in this time and in this season, the only reason he's bringing you back is to let the world know that the enemy may have wounded you, but he did not break you. The only reason he allowed you to move in the way that you're moving, come back with what you came back from, and be present as you are now, is to show the entire world that whatever the enemy does, God can undo it, fix it, and make it better than it was before. Will you just tell somebody beside you, he's telling my story. I know I'm preaching to some of y'all in here today. Some of y'all can say, I've been through it, but I came out of it. And it didn't look like I was going to survive, but I did. And not only did I survive, but I am succeeding in this season in my life. I don't have everything that I want, but I got what I need. I don't dot every I, don't cross every T, but my life is fairly well. Am I preaching to anybody in here who has a comeback story? I'm going to get back to the text in a minute, but last week I told you to prophesy your comeback. Is there anybody in here against the face, in the face of all impossibility, who would dare just begin to prophesy your own comeback? Will you touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, I am here today by the power of God, by the blood of Jesus, and by the word of my testimony. I said I wasn't going to be down always. I said trouble wasn't going to last always. I said my life wasn't going to always be in shame. I said I wasn't always going to be in lack. I said I wasn't going to always be on the bottom. I said I wasn't going to always be in pain. Somebody lift your hand, open your mouth and shout, I prophesied my own comeback. And the disciples have seen all of this. And Jesus takes the opportunity, Minister Tammy Williams, Minister Neil, to create context for their commission. Based upon what you've seen me go through and come back from, I need you to understand that your responsibility, watch this, is to preach repentance for the forgiveness of sins in my name. He says the authority by which you can preach is because you've seen it with your own eyes. If my granddaddy was here, Reverend A.J. Brewer of the First Baptist Church in Kannapolis, North Carolina, he said, you can't make me doubt him. I know too much about you. Seen it with your own eyes. You heard me give you the narrative. You've heard me share with you the story. And now I'm going to send you what my Father has promised.
We know what the promise was. The promise was the promise of the Holy Spirit, the promise of the Comforter, the promise that Jesus made in John 16 when he said, I'm not going to leave you comfortless. It's going to look like you're alone, but you ain't alone. They ain't going to see me with you, but just because they don't see me with you don't mean that I ain't with you. I'm talking in here today. It's going to look like you're by yourself, but you ain't by yourself. You might be alone, but you ain't lonely. God have mercy, because I am with you, he says, and now I'm going to send you the one who will not only be with you, but I'm going to send you the one who will lead you into all truth and righteousness, who will take those things that I've shared with you that you didn't understand then, but he's going to teach you those things now. But watch this. In order for him to come, you have to wait right where you are. My brothers and my sisters, I'm not going to preach long to you today, but I need somebody to understand that what God is saying to us in this season, before you come out of hiding, you might need to wait for the power to deal with what's coming next. Let me say that again. Don't move prematurely just because you know your purpose. Talk Kevin Long, I think I will. Don't just put yourself out there when God has not released you. And here is the problem with many of us. We see what God has for us, but we go for it and after it in our own strength. Let me say that. Not you, but somebody that you know. Here's their testimony. I wish I had waited. somebody you know is in their head over debt. Over their head in debt. Because they went to get a blessing that God wanted to send to them. And whenever we do things in our own effort, God is not responsible for upholding our decision. I'm gonna preach whether you want me to or not. Jesus says something to them that's really interesting. The Bible says, he says to them, you all have seen what I've gone through. But just because I went through it, it does not mean that you're ready to go through it at this time. Oh, y'all miss what I said. You are going to need the same power that raised me from the dead, that sustained me through the process, in order for you to be sustained through the process that you're getting ready to go through yourself. And I'm preaching to somebody in here who needs to hear this. God is not holding you back. God is not holding you down. What God is doing is he has you in a season of waiting for something that you can't handle right now. Oh, God, I hear you complaining. I hear you complaining. They got theirs, God, and it's time for me to get my. What's the difference between me and them? And God wants you to know that his timing is what you ought to be after in this season. Because whenever you move in the timing of God, talk Kevin Long, I think I will. God then upholds whatever you do because you're submitted to what he has purposed for your life. Yes. Tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, wait. Wait. Now, I don't know what you're telling them to wait on, but somebody's about to get in some real trouble because they're moving before time. Somebody's about to get in some real turmoil because they're moving before God has told. God showed you that it's yours. God showed you that it belongs to you. But just because he shows it to you now, it doesn't mean that it's yours right now. Talk Kevin Long, I think I will. God showed Joseph what his future was, but it took 14 years of preparation before he was ready for it. And the enemy has somebody in here complaining about where you are now when your actual response ought to be, God, I thank you that I have purpose and you're protecting me by keeping me where I am until I'm ready for where you want me to be. Is there anybody in here besides me who can look back over your life and give God glory, praise, and honor? Watch this. Because he didn't let you get it when you wanted it. Oh, I'm going to preach whether you want me to or not. Is there anybody in here besides me who can look back over your life and say, I cried because I couldn't move forward then, but now I look back over my life and I realize I wasn't ready for what I thought I wanted then. And as a matter of fact, watch this, my values have changed. Talk, Kevin Long, I think I will. I said, my values have changed. I used to want to ride in luxury. Now I want to ride in something that can get me from point A to point B, that ain't going to keep me up at night trying to figure out how I'm going to keep. I want to ride in something that I ain't got to hide behind the house. I want to ride in something that I ain't got to hide in the garage. I want to ride in something, I wish I had a few witnesses in here, that I can afford, I can eat, I can do everything else I need to do. Lift your hands and shout, yes, Lord. I'm almost done. So the text says, somebody shout, text says, he says, I'm going to send you what I promised, but stay. Somebody ought to shout, stay. Just wait in the city until you've been clothed with power from on high. I'm going to send it to you. And if God sends it, it means you ain't got to go get it. I don't know who I'm preaching to, but you know what the word says. You know what our theme is, Matthew 6 and 33. Seek ye first his kingdom and his righteousness, and everything you want, I'll release you to go get it. Did I quote that right? Seek ye first his kingdom and his righteousness, and you can go pick out whatever you want. No, he said seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these other things shall be added unto you. Seems to me he's saying just wait. Oh, I'm preaching with you, woman, tuna. Submit yourself to the season that I have you in and just wait. And when you wait, I will release everything to you that I promise you. Somebody in here under the sound of my voice is getting ready to have a new lease on life. You're going to leave here understanding that the reason that God has you in the season that you're in right now is because he's got something ready for you, but you ain't ready for it. And what you were willing to compromise yourself for, what you were willing to work night and day for, what you were willing to sweat for, what you were willing to lose so much stuff for, that wasn't in God's will for your life right now, it's going to come to you in God's timing. Will you touch somebody and say, it's all in God's timing? I need about 15 people in here who can praise, watch this, not just about the purpose of God, but about the timing of God. And I can tell you how you can praise him, because when you look at where you are right now, it would suggest that you, if you don't have it yet, that God is sustaining you until it's time. Will you just touch your neighbor and say, married neighbor, he's sustaining you until you're ready for it. He's sustaining you until it's time for it to be in your presence, be in your grasp. Lift your hands, open your mouth and shout, Lord, I thank you for sustaining me. I want to drop these three things on you, and I'm going to get out of here. Yes. Number one, y'all, tell your neighbor, just wait. Number one, I need you to understand this. In order to wait, you have to understand, hear this, that waiting is a sign of spiritual maturity. Let me say that again. That your willingness to wait is a sign of spiritual maturity. I'm not making it up. It's right here on the text. Jesus said to them, he said, I've commissioned y'all. I've given you your assignment. I've created the context. You know your purpose, but you also need to be in sync with the timing. And the text says in verse 50, when he had led them out to the vicinity of Bethany, he lifted up his hands and blessed him. Bethany, my brothers and my sisters, watch this, is by way of the Hebrew language, it is the house of ripe fruit. And wherever you see ripe fruit, it is symbolic of maturity. I'm going to preach whether y'all want me to or not. It's interesting that it was at Bethany where Jesus returned or turned aside often to the house of his friends Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. It's interesting that the last time they were in Bethany, it was Mary who anointed Jesus for his burial. It was Martha who served at the table. It was Lazarus who sat with them. What I'm trying to tell you, my brothers and my sisters, is it was in the setting of Bethany that Jesus's ministry, that it was culminated, it came into its full maturation. She anointed him with oil, prepared him, which means that he was ready for burial. Y'all gonna catch this in a minute. God wants me to tell you, my brother and my sister, that one of the greatest temptations the enemy will ever present to you is premature movement. One of the greatest temptations that the enemy will throw at you is moving outside of the timing of God. The Bible lets us know that Jesus led them to the last place that they witnessed, watch this, or led them to the place where they witnessed him being anointed or made ready for his final act in the earth as Messiah. That he was anointed, his body was anointed for the purpose of him being buried after his death. I don't know who I'm preaching to today, but I need you to understand that a sign of spiritual maturity is the ability just to sit down somewhere and just wait for things to play out. Talk Kevin Long, I think I will. A sign of spiritual maturity is when, watch this, you are not zealous or anxious for anything, that you sit in a place of maturity, and watch this, you are comfortable where you are until it's time for you to move to the next place. Y'all miss what I said? I said comfortable. Touch your neighbor and say comfortable. I wonder how many of you, I don't talk to your neighbor now, talk to yourself. How many of you are comfortable with waiting? How
many of you are comfortable with waiting when it looks like everybody is passing you by? When it looks like everybody that you started out with is getting there faster than you? When it looks like that they got their house and they picket fence and they 2.5 children and they dog and all that kind of stuff, and you still living in your apartment? How many of us are comfortable, watch this, so much that we don't have to compare ourselves to anybody else? That when I understand that it's in God's timing, I can be where I am, be who I am, and be comfortable in that and still be happy for you. Will you touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, it's time for us to grow up. It's time for us to grow up, because waiting is a sign of spiritual maturity. Oh God, the older I get, the more I realize that when you are spiritually mature, you ain't trying to keep up with the Joneses. Oh God, when the older I get, the more I realize when you're spiritually mature and just comfortable in where you are in your process, you can celebrate somebody, watch this, who ain't anointed as you are, but they have greater platforms than you have. Will you touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, it's time for us to mature. It's time for us to be in the place, I'm gonna preach whether y'all want me to or not, where John the Baptist says about Jesus, listen, he must increase so I must decrease. In other words, it don't make me no less of who I am just because I ain't got the spotlight, just because I ain't got the bling, just because I ain't got the flash. Will you touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, just learn how to be mature and wait. I'm talking to somebody in here. Don't you dare get fooled up and hooked up with nobody because your girlfriend done got fooled up and hooked up with somebody. She pregnant and now she about to have a baby. Now you can't let her out, do you? And you, when you get ready for it, God will send you who you need so that you ain't gotta be in anguish. Am I preaching to anybody in here who knows I'm talking right? You gotta be mature enough just to wait on the timing of God. I'm going to send you the promise. Bible says I'm going to send you to the place of Bethany. I want you to be in the place, and I'm almost done. I want you to be in the place, hallelujah, the place where you are comfortable in your maturity. God have mercy. Somebody ought to shout, comfortable in my maturity. I'm comfortable where I am right now. I ain't got to keep up with nobody. I'm comfortable where I am right now. I ain't in competition with nobody but me. I'm comfortable where I am right now. I ain't got nothing to prove to nobody. I'm comfortable where I am. I'm comfortable where I am with what I have. I'm comfortable with who I know. I ain't got a brown nose. I ain't got to force myself in the settings. God have mercy. I wish I had a few witnesses there. I'm comfortable. Lift your hand. Shout, I'm comfortable where I am. He lifted his hands. Watch this. And he blessed them in Bethany. I wish I had a witness. Now the promise is going to come to Jerusalem. But he blessed them in Bethany. I'm going to preach to whether y'all want me to or not. Some of you don't realize the blessing of being blessed by him in secret. I'm going to talk whether you want me to or not. Let me see if I can fix that. Pinda, yeah, you remember a man by the name of Jairus had a daughter who was sick. And the Bible says she was dying, and then Jesus was stopped by a woman with an issue of blood on his way to go see Jairus' daughter. And by the time Jesus got through with the woman with the issue of blood, the Bible says that somebody came from Jairus' house and said, it's too late, don't trouble the master, your daughter is dead. The Bible says that Jesus turned to Jairus and said, don't listen to them.
take me to the house. And notice what happens. The Bible says that when Jesus got there, he said to them, well, why are you crying? The girl's not dead. She's sleeping. And the people laughed Jesus to scorn. But the next thing that Jesus did is what I want to drop on you. Somebody shout, drop it on us. The Bible says that he took Jairus and his wife, Peter, James, and John into the room and shut everybody else out. And behind closed doors, Jesus raised the daughter and said, don't bring her out immediately. Just strengthen her. I'm prophesying over you right now. In your season, while you're waiting, God's getting ready to perform some behind closed doors blessings. Will you just touch yourself and say, self, I'm ready for the behind closed doors blessing, the blessings that don't need no attention, the blessing that I ain't got to advertise, the blessing that I ain't got to tell nobody about. I came to prophesy it here. If you'll receive it, God's getting ready to do some stuff in secret for you, that when you come out in the open, people are gonna believe its magnitude. Lift your hands, open your mouth, and shout, yes, Lord. So you got to be mature enough to wait until he does it. And sometimes he going to do it behind closed doors. Somebody shout, Lord, bless me behind closed doors. Bless me with a blessing that before I put it on social media, I'm just going to sit with it for a minute. Bless me with a blessing that before I show it off, I'm just going to, I'm preaching whether y'all want to or not, I'm just going to wear it in select places and be in it in places around folk that I don't know. Bless me. Bless me in such a way, God. Bless me in secret so that when people talk about where I was, they won't realize I was there, but I ain't there no more. Will you lift your hands, open your mouth and shout, Lord, bless me in secret. Behind closed door blessing. The Bible says that while he was blessing him, he left him, he was taken up to heaven. Here's the next thing I need y'all to understand. If you're gonna wait, waiting is time for you to perfect the art of worship. Y'all miss what I said. Worship while you wait. I ain't making it up. It's right here in verse 52. The Bible says Jesus led them to Bethany. He was blessing them, taken away from them. And when he was taken up to heaven, the Bible says, then they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem. Watch this, with great joy. Now, that might not mean anything to you until you understand that their worship was a response to what he did because they were committed to waiting. Y'all miss what I said. They worshiped because Jesus had blessed them outside of Jerusalem in the Bethany, in the vicinity of Bethany. He blessed them behind closed doors, and they worshiped him, watch this, because he showed up where they were. Oh, my brothers and my sisters, tomorrow you might want to mark your calendars, because tomorrow is the day that the great American eclipse will take place. One happened in 2017 and went one way across the nation, and another's gonna happen tomorrow, 7 years later. Catch the numerics, the numerology, and it's gonna cross the other side of the nation. It's going to make an X over the United States of America.
And there are spiritual implications as to what some believe is happening, that there is going to be a call on the carpet to America for all that it has done by way of treachery and by way of all the evil that it has done under and in the name of God. And my brothers and my sisters, whatever that means, I want to suggest something else to you. That the eclipse, watch this, is when the moon moves in front of the sun. And there are people nowadays who are fascinated by eclipses. There are people who want to know when it's going to be over their city, and they go get sunglasses and have watch parties and all that kind of stuff. But when I was growing up in Nanny Brewer's house, that's my grandma, whenever there was an eclipse, my grandma would forbid me to go outside and look up at the eclipse. Boy, if you look at the eclipse, you're going to go blind. Y'all remember, I don't care what kind of sunglasses you got, don't look at it, because God is doing his work. And my grandmama used to make us, when the eclipse would happen, she'd make us come in the house. And she turned the TV off, and she go back in that room where my Aunt Hattie used to sleep and close herself up in the closet, and she go to praying, and she go to lining up hymns, God must Jesus bear the cross alone, and all the world go free. No, there's a cross for everyone, and I know there's a cross for me. She go to singing Amazing Grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, and now I see. And she'd sing a little bit, and then the tone of her voice would drop some, and I'd hear some mumbling, and mother would be in there. Every once in a while, she'd mumble out here, say, "Oh, Lord, Lord," and she'd be calling out the names of all of her children and her grandchildren. While the eclipse was happening, she took the opportunity to let God do his work, God have mercy, and to sit and to pray and to worship, because she realized that eclipse signified a shift. And y'all might not like this, but my grandmama thought that it was time to pray during that time, because if you prayed while a shift was happening, if you worshiped while a shift was taking place, God was going to do whatever you asked him to do. Now, I don't mean to mess with y'all today, but I'm telling you that you need to learn that if God has you in a season of waiting, you need to worship him. I'm going to preach whether y'all want me to or not. When God has you in a place behind closed doors, when God has you in a place where he's not allowing you to move, when God has you in a place where your purpose has not yet manifested, instead of moving in your own timing, now is the time for you to get close to him. And the way to get close to him is to approach him in worship. Do I have any worshipers in here? Do I have any people who understand the power of worshiping him in your dark seasons, in your seasons when it looks like you are being held back and held down? Will you touch your neighbor, say, "Neighbor, as it relates to tomorrow, don't you go outside trying to see the moon in front of the sun. You gonna mess around and lose your sight. But what you ought to do is take time to worship God, because a shift is about to take place." Will you touch your neighbor, say, "Neighbor, I feel a shift is about to take place, and I want to be ready when the shift happens. So I need to hear God's voice
never heard it. I need to see his hand in a way I've never seen it. So in this season, instead of me moving prematurely, I'm going to take this time to worship him. Lift your hands and worship him. Is there anybody in here who's ready for a shift? Well, lift your hands and worship him. I'm prophesying now a shift in your finances, a shift in your health, a shift in your employment, a shift in your business. But it ain't gonna shift unless you use this downtime to worship him. God is arranging some stuff in the cosmos. God is doing some stuff in the heavenlies, that he's going to move what's in your way, out of your way, and give you power to do what he called you to do. Shout yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus Christ. Touch me, sir. Help me to preach your holy word. The Bible says, then they worship him. Watch this. And they returned to Jerusalem. Yes. Now, I told y'all last week that the place of your empowerment is the place of your endangerment. That in other words, God will not move you away from the enemy to bless you, but he'll bless you in the very presence of your enemy. Here is what gives me great joy in this text. For the text says, somebody shout, the text says, after they worshiped, they went back to Jerusalem. And watch this. And they stayed continually at the temple praising God. Now let me tell you what this means, and I'm gonna let y'all go. They didn't spend 24 hours a day, 7 days a week in the temple. But as often as corporate worship took place, the people who were commissioned by Jesus showed up in the place of public worship despite the presence of the adversary. Y'all miss what I said. In this season, I'm talking to you, TCI, and I'm talking to those of you who are watching who may not be members of TCI, but you're a member of some other church. I need to tell you this, that while you're waiting, not only should you worship in private, but you should recommit to public worship. Amen. Oh no, y'all miss what I said. Let me say it again. Let me see if I can say it in a way that you can understand it. Get up and go back to church. Okay. All right. The word of God says that we should not forsake the assembling together of ourselves as the manner of some is. The pandemic did not start the phenomenon of people not going to church. I'm going to preach whether you want me to or not. Historically, we find, especially in the 20th and 21st century, before the pandemic, that people had gotten to a place of comfortability where they could have church at the click of a button and at the click of a remote. God have mercy. They could stay at home and have their worship experience. I'm going to preach whether you want me to or not. But here is what this text teaches me. At one of the most cataclysmic points in the life of the church, the people of God did not stay home, but they went to the house to worship. Y'all,
y'all missing this. I can remember, and I'm closing now, Ira, and I might holler and I might not. I can remember in 1976, where there was the Iran crisis, and gas was high. Y'all remember that, don't you, mothers? And lines were long. But then churches were full. I remember when the Gulf War happened, and stuff was going on over in Afghanistan. And you know, anytime something happens in the Middle East, folk get all out of sorts, and they ran straight to the church. I remember 9/11. Hallelujah. When bin Laden commissioned the planes to hit the Twin Towers, you couldn't keep folk out of church. I remember when the pandemic was lifted, you found people being convenient with being able to stay at home and watch their favorites on Facebook and streaming services and the like. But let another tragedy happen. When folk think the end is going to come, churches will be filled again. Talk, Kevin Long, I think I will. And God says to the disciples in the text, he says, because I am causing you to wait, and because I am blessing you privately, you ought to come out and give me praise publicly. Will you touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, this is no time to stay at home. This is, I know you got enemies and adversaries that are against you, but God said when the season of waiting is over, I'm going to send you out, but I'm going to send you out with power. Will you touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, he's getting ready to give you power. And the power that he gives you is going to help you to withstand anything that the enemy may throw at you. It is not that the enemy has changed his mind or his ways. It's just that God is giving you power that you didn't have before. And now what you used to run from, you'll be able to stand 10 toes down. Look it straight in the face and declare, Satan, the Lord rebuke you. Will you touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, in this season, you better get ready now to be public with your testimony. God is about to let some of you go public with your power. He's about to call some of you out of hiding. And he's about to call some of you out of seclusion because you waited on him to do what needed to be done. You waited on him to shift what needed to be shifted. And you waited on him to give you what you needed for the next season of your life. Will you touch your neighbor and say, hey, neighbor, God's going to reward you for your waiting. And the Bible declares that they went to Jerusalem, and every time the doors of the church opened, they worshiped in the face of those who were trying to take them out.
because they understood something. They understood that even though weapons formed, the weapons would not prosper. Will you grab one more neighbor and say, neighbor, in this next season, you're going to have power to stand in the face of what the enemy meant for evil. In this next season, he's going to give you power to deal with unruly and hating co-workers. Touch one more neighbor and say, neighbor, it's time for you to make up in your mind that you'll no longer hide from what the enemy's trying to do. But when God gives you power, you're going to step in an old situation with a new mindset and a new determination and a new commitment to do what God has told you to do. Can I go high? Will you touch one more neighbor? Say, neighbor, you'll be glad that you waited, because when God releases you, the enemy won't have any power over you. You told the wrong neighbor. Tell one more person. Say, neighbor, oh neighbor, God is getting ready to give you timing and purpose. Y'all miss what I said. You know what your purpose is. You know what God has equipped you to do. You know what God has assigned. But it wasn't time then. But he's getting ready to release you in divine timing, so that everything that he promised you will come to pass. Can I go high? I came to tell somebody in here that there is a blessing in learning how to wait. If you wait on the Lord, he will fight your battles for you. If you wait on the Lord, he'll bring valleys up and bring mountains down. If you wait on the Lord, he'll make crooked places straight and make rough places smooth. If you wait on the Lord, he'll turn your night into day. If you wait on the Lord, he'll turn your morning into dancing. If you wait on the Lord, he'll turn your beauty, give you beauty for your ashes. Will you tell your neighbor, just wait on the Lord? Can I go high? I'm preaching to somebody now to let you know that your time is closer than you think. You ain't got as long to wait as you've had to wait in the past. Hallelujah, in here, God has called you to a level of spiritual maturity so that you can wait until the coast is clear. God is blessing you in secret until it's time for you to go public. God is blessing you in such a way that you'll be able to walk in the face of all kinds of attacks, all kinds of onslaughts, all kinds of insults, and declare, the Lord is with me. Will you touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, oh neighbor, get ready for your re-release. He's going to release you, and when he releases you, you're going to have power that you've never had before. You're going to have power to stand and withstand the wiles of the devil. Tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, God's getting ready to reward your waiting. You didn't compromise. You didn't take shortcuts. You didn't move on your own timing. You didn't move in your own power. but you decided to wait on him. And because you waited, he's going to prove to you that it was worth the wait. Tell three people, whatever you're waiting for is worth the wait. He's giving you power. He's giving you ability. He's giving you wherewithal to be able to handle what you weren't able to handle in your last season. Can I go higher? Tell your neighbor, and the reason you need power is because with power comes persecution. And if you think they didn't like you then, they won't be able to stand you when your promise manifests in your life. So God is giving you thick skin. God is giving you the mindset of a victor. God is giving you the eyesight of an eagle. He's giving you the ability to see past what's in front of you. Touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, he's getting ready to elevate you above everything that the enemy's purpose to stop your progress. Can I go higher? Tell one more neighbor. Say, neighbor, this is the season where you gotta be willing, like the eagle, to fly by yourself. Eagles don't fly in packs. Eagles fly by themselves. Lift your hands and receive the eagle's anointing. Can I go higher? Lord, anoint your people to fly above criticism. Anoint your people to fly above naysayers. Anoint your people to fly above hate. Anoint your people to fly above ridicule. Anoint your people to fly above persecution. For this promise is about to take them to another level. So anoint your people to go higher in you. Go higher in purpose. Go higher in favor. Go higher in their prayer life. Go higher in their worship. Go higher in their devotion. Go higher in the things of God. Will you tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, let's go higher. Let's go higher. Let's go higher. Yay! Lord, lift me up. Lord, let me stand. Table ain't no higher place that I found. Plant my feet on higher. On higher ground. Touch your neighbor. Say, neighbor, we're going to higher ground. And when they go low, we go high. When they go low, we go higher. Shout yay! Shout yay! Shout yes! Shout yes! Shout yes! Weapons will form. Prosper, go higher. The enemy will come in like a flood. Go higher, for the Spirit of the Lord will raise up a standard against you. Touch as many people as you can and say, neighbor, let's go higher, higher, higher. a shift, and we're shifting higher. Shout higher. Shout higher. Shout higher. Yeah, 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 yeah. He's getting ready to reward your waiting. He's getting ready to reward your worship. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. I prophesy higher. TCI, I prophesy higher. Just wait, just wait, just wait, just wait. If you can receive this, God told me, as low as you went in your last season is as high as you going in your next season. Tell your neighbor, neighbor, if your last season was a low season, get ready for your next season to be a high season. Your wings. Where are my eagles? Where are my eagles? Let it lift you. Let it raise you. Let it elevate you. Go higher. Go higher. Go higher. You didn't go through that for nothing. You didn't go through that for nothing. You didn't lose that for nothing. I'm just waiting. I'm just waiting. Lift those hands where you are. Continue to worship him. Yeah. Yes, God. Oh, God, we thank you. I've shown you your purpose. But I need you to wait. I've commissioned you. That's what he says, Peter. He says, all this happened, and you were witness. Elder Gray, hear me, son. And you were a witness to it so that the gospel could be preached. But what I've assigned you to do, you can't do in your own power. Not only can you not do it in your own timing, but you can't do it in your own power. So just go wait. And I want you to wait. In the place of endangerment. Because I want to prove to you that I can keep you from it. Keep you in the midst of it.
Right.
Until I release you from it. And for some of you, God is proving, for some of us, he's proving that he can keep us in the midst of the process. Shalon, Ira, I love this about God. The more I read in the scriptures, the more I see, is God will keep you in it. And in keeping you in it, he's keeping you from the effects of it until he brings you out of it. And he never brings you out of anything, watch this, unless he's sending you into something else. And he never, hear me, and he never sends you into something else without equipping you to handle whatever that next season is. So Pharaoh wants to kill every male child under 2 years old. Y'all got to catch this. And his mama puts him in a basket, pitches it with tar, sends him down the Nile River.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Where his sister Miriam gets him.
Right.
And watch this. Moses becomes the adopted son of Pharaoh's daughter. And for 40 years, he grows up as an Egyptian. Y'all got to catch this. His purpose was not fully fulfilled. So he keeps him in that place until he murders the guy. And now he has to go to the wilderness for another 40 years. And God keeps him in the wilderness until he releases him to go, watch this, back to Egypt. Are y'all seeing the parallels? Jesus said, don't stay outside of Jerusalem. I'm going to send you there. I'm going to empower you there. I'm going to give you the wisdom, the knowledge, the insight. I'm going to give you everything you need for your next season there. And some of you don't even understand that God is holding you in a place called there. I can give you a pretty good indication of whether or not you're there. If you've been praying for God to get you out of it, or you've been praying for God to stop it and he hadn't gotten you out of it and it hadn't stopped, you there. So he wants to work fear out of you there. He wants to work doubt out of you there. Are y'all hearing me?
Yes.
Here's your commission. I want you to go, but I don't want you to go yet. I want you to go back there and wait. Stay. I made the promise, but the promise is time sensitive. It is a time released promise. And you don't know when it's going to happen. You just got to wait. Oh God, all this was in my notes. I didn't know. We getting ready to go. Jesus understood purpose and timing. And he understood that every prophecy was time stamped. I think I will, daughter. Everything that God has said about you is time stamped. You hear me saying? You hear me, Phyllis? Everything that God has said is time stamped. And when is your time? And let me add this. When is your time and God's timing, nothing can stop you. You know what blows my mind? That not one of the 11 apostles, and to my knowledge, any of the other people who were followers of Jesus who were in that upper room, not one of them encountered or incurred any sort of injury after they came out with power. Y'all missing what I'm saying? Rhonda, they had people were out to kill them. But they couldn't touch him, wife. Because the prophecy was time stamped. And whenever, Deacon Andrew Greer, Deacon Fat, Deacon Marcia, Deacon Pam Hamilton, Deacon Marcia, all you deacons over there, Deacon Nikki. Whenever, Deacon John Abraham, don't let me leave the fellas out. Deacon Mike Hamilton. Salaam. Listen. When it's time stamped,
yeah.
I don't care what the enemy tries. He can't stop it. So Pharaoh said, kill every male Hebrew child from 2 years and under that we might get their deliverer. Are y'all hearing me? And Herod said the same thing. Kill every child in the vicinity of Bethlehem of New Judea that we might kill them all so that we might kill the Messiah. But because the prophecy was time stamped, Jesus didn't just live through what Herod tried. He lived for 33 years. Because when it's time, when it's your time and when it's God's timing, I'm telling y'all, nothing can stop it. And let me tell you what you and I have been guilty of. We've been guilty of trying to push prophecy prematurely. I see it now, so I gotta have it now. I see it now, so I gotta prove who I am now. And sometime David, son of Jesse, but you can take this word for yourself. Sometimes Samuel will anoint you and you got to go right back to the sheep field with your anointing. How do you deal with it when you're anointed to be a king, but your assignment as an under shepherd ain't over? I know my purpose, but God has not released me to it yet. Some of you single sisters need to understand this. The Bible says that he that findeth a wife findeth a good thing and obtains favor. When he finds her, she's already a wife. He don't marry her to make her one. Here's what we need to learn this season. Thank you, Holy Ghost. We need to learn how to manage who we have been anointed to be and the season that we're in presently so they can peacefully coexist until I grow into that season of the fullness of who I've been created to be. We got to learn how to manage it. Got to learn. They have to peacefully coexist. We got to learn how to be a boss. Mm-hmm. And a servant. We got to learn how to be a servant and a boss in a servant's body.
Amen, Bishop. Amen. Amen. Yes. Yes. Yes.
If you're a Pittsburgh Steelers fan, don't take this for anything more than an illustration. So Justin Fields was a first stringer in Chicago. Now he's going to be a backup in Pittsburgh to Russell Wilson. He is a first stringer in a backup role. Can you be a first stringer in a backup role? Peter, you're going to prophesy on Pentecost, but you can't do it until Pentecost. So just wait. I told you who you were in Caesarea Philippi. Up on this rock, I'm going to build my church. I told you who you were, but just because I told you who you were don't mean that you're the fullness of it right now. And I don't know who I'm talking to. Don't get caught trying to manage and maintain what God has not mandated and ordained. You'll be playing catch up for the rest of your life. Let's stand. We're getting ready to pray. And I'm telling you, what time is it? Okay, let's, yeah, we good. All right. So we're going to pray. And I want to pray for those of you who say, you know what, Bishop? This message was for me because I'm somewhere in between seeing it and waiting for it. Whatever it is. And God has me in this season, watch this, of learning how to be mature and just waiting. I'm gonna call it a few things now. Impulsiveness or impulsivity, people who just move on impulse, and we want to be delivered from moving on impulse, making decisions that we can't manage. I know that God has this for me. I know that he wants this for me. And I see it and I get it. And every time I move prematurely, I find myself dealing with more problems than I'm ready to deal with. There are others of you who are frustrated, who the enemy's trying to make think it's never going to happen. And you've given up. You're trying to find alternate and alternatives to what God has shown you. You're trying to make things happen in your own power. This message was for you today. God says, if you wait and spend this time waiting, being intimate with me, just let me do my work. Don't go out there and look at that eclipse. Let me do my work. I'm causing things to shift in the cosmos. I just need you in my presence. The altar is open for those of you who say, you know what, Bishop, I need a shift in the and I know I can't make it happen in my own. So if you're in any of those categories today, I want you to come. If you just need prayer, I want you to come. The altar is open. I want to pray with you. Thank you so much. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I don't know if any of you remember, but in 2022, I said that 2024 would be the year where we would see the advent of the kingdom of God in the earth. Where, again, I'll go back to this. We're doing this series on the Exodus and how God was destroying systems and structures and dismantling things that held people down. And that's what the people are saying about this eclipse, that this eclipse is literally God putting an X, the first one in 2017, the next one coming this way in 2024. He's marking the United States for something. And whenever God brings it, listen, whenever God brings a nation into judgment, he always protects his people while they're in it. Yes, sir. Don't be surprised that in this season, if some strange things start happening in your favor, God has still promised that you would acquire houses that you did not build. Thank you, God. Now, this ain't my prediction. I'm just telling what the Lord said. I don't know what's going to happen. And you would acquire vineyards that you did not plant. Yes.
He did say that the wealth of the wicked is laid up for the righteous, the just, those who are in right standing with God. So don't be surprised if some stuff happens in your finances, some debt cancellation, some stuff that you, don't be surprised if, I'm not telling you this is going to happen, but I feel the Lord is releasing me to at least paint this portrait of possibilities. Don't be surprised if God starts doing stuff in your finances by way of wealth transfer.
Thank you, God. Thank you. Thank you, God. Thank you, God.
Keep working on your credit. Keep fixing, but don't be surprised. Watch this. If Matthew 6 and 33 doesn't start manifesting in your life, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and things will be added unto you. I ain't saying that it's gonna happen, but I believe that God can do it. So I want to pray for you now, and we're going to close. Join hands with somebody at the altar, if you will, especially if you came with somebody, because I feel things are shifting in families and bloodlines. I feel things are shifting in families and bloodlines. Have them to bring the children out, because I want to pray for the children. Lady and I were talking the other day about how it seems like there's this attack on children. On their minds, on their lives. I want to pray for families and bloodlines today. Pray for marriages and the like. Are they outside? They are. Okay. Hallelujah. Let's worship while they come. Come on, let's worship while they come. Listen, Hey, y'all. Elder Simmons, will you come? I want to pray with and for you as well. I didn't mean to mess up your flow, but the Lord just led me to pray for families and bloodlines. But I'm praying for you and Lady Kiana and all who work with our youth, because this is a time of intense ministry for them. And you and I hadn't had this in-depth conversation, but what the Lord is doing even now in the youth ministry of TCI is a powerful acts to and move. He's pouring out his spirit upon all flesh. And sons and daughters will be used by God. Youth, children will be used by God. So I just wanted you to be here as we pray. Let's pray together. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for this time of prayer and this time of petitioning you. We thank you for your word today. You promised us power to be and to do who you've created and called us to be, but you said we would do that in the face of opposition and in the face of difficulty. So first of all, Father, we pray for these children who are living in a mean world, children who are living in a world whose culture is not friendly to Christian values. But God, we pray for them now. We ask you to keep them in your care. We plead the blood of Jesus over our children. We declare that no physical harm or violence will come up on or even near them. We pray for their minds. We declare, God, that no demonic or satanic influences of this age will corrupt their mind, corrupt their thinking, corrupt their acting, corrupt their ways, that they will walk differently in this time and in this season, Father. We pray, God, that you would keep them from predators. Who would try to harm their bodies and who would try, Father, to get into their minds, God, and to convince them of things other than what they have been taught, things that they have been told. Father, we plead the blood of Jesus over them now. And we ask, Father, that you would literally draw them close to you. Speak to them even in their youth. Get them accustomed to your presence in their lives. In Jesus' mighty name. God, we come against any generational curses that are on the bloodlines of these children. In the name of Jesus, we declare and decree that they will not be tainted, that they will not be marred, that they will not be controlled, that they will not be victimized by this present age. Father, we thank you that they have wisdom well beyond their years to make choices even when they're out of the presence of their parents. God, that will cause them to be healthy, God, in their mind, their bodies, and in their spirits. God, we ask you now, God, to show them the path on which you have ordered their feet to walk, God. Thank you right now in the mighty and majestic name of Jesus for a generation that is being raised up, Father, who will honor you, God, in all
all of their ways. Now, God, I pray for these others who are at this altar. I pray, God, now for the parents of these children. God, give them wisdom. Give them knowledge, God. Give them insight as to how to raise these children and to protect their anointing, God, in the mighty and majestic name of Jesus. And God, everyone else at this altar, I pray for every household that is represented. I pray for every marriage that is represented. I pray for every family that is represented. I pray for every bloodline that is represented. God, I cover them in the blood of Jesus. And I ask you now, God, to keep us in this season of transition, this season of change. And God, be true to your word. You said, God, that you would bless those, Father, who bless you. And so today, in the name of Jesus, I speak blessings and favor over each and every family, household, bloodline, marriage that is represented at this altar. In the mighty and majestic name of Jesus, break every yoke, loose every chain, bind every hindering spirit. In the name of Jesus, cast the devils out of our mind, and don't let our souls be ashamed. And God, we now embrace this new season, this new day, this new era, this shift in our lives, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, come on. In the name of Jesus. Lift your hands and worship him, please. Favor on your life, favor on your family, favor on your bloodline, favor on your everything that concerns you, favor. Receive it. I don't know what the shift is going to be, but I know it's going to be in your favor. I know that whatever the enemy is planning for you and your family, it will not work. Hallelujah. Father, now I anoint this your servant. Thank you, Father, that he has a Joshua's anointing on his life. That he'll lead young people into promise. That he'll lead young people into places and spaces in which their presence will be known and felt. And God, give him good success in every area. Bless everything concerning him and Lady Kiana. Bless every business venture. Bless their finances. Free them up so they can freely serve. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Come on, give the Lord a hand clap of praise. To all my young people, I hadn't had a chance to hang out with you. I'm so glad to see so many of you today. I want y'all to look at me. Bishop loves you. All right? Bishop, Lady T, where's Lady T? All right. Who? Yes. Bishop loves you. Lady T loves you. We love you. And I want y'all to know that y'all are just y'all protected. You're so special from God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That nothing and nobody will be able to harm you all of your days. That no bully, that no predator,
that no evil person will be able to come near you. In Jesus' mighty name. In Jesus' mighty name. I love y'all so much. Yes, ma'am. Who did I miss? Right here? Where? Oh, I didn't see him. Hey, buddy. All right. All right. All right. I love y'all. I love y'all. I love y'all. Y'all love me? Y'all love me? No, I love you so much. Elder Bees, you can... I didn't mean to interrupt your flow, man. Y'all can go back with Pastor... What do they call you? Elder B. Y'all can go back with Elder B. All right. Everybody else, you can go back to your seat, and we're going to share in communion, and we're leaving. If there's anybody here who does not know Jesus Christ as his or her personal Lord and Savior, you can know him right now in the free pardon of your sins. If you will just repeat this prayer after me, Lord, save me, and he will. For the word of God says, whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall not be ashamed. And if that's you and you've decided to make Jesus Christ your personal Lord and Savior today, would you come while we're yet in this moment of worship? Would you please come? Is there one? Also, if you're not connected to any church family and you believe that TCI is the place for you, if you believe that this is the place, we'd love to be your church family. Yes, love to cover you. Love to show you the path of destiny and help you to walk on that path. Show you your area of gifting. Activate that gift. Help to activate it so that you can be who God has created and called you to be. If that's you, would you come? If you're watching also and you've given your life to Christ, we ask, my brother, my sister, that you would let us know by going to our website, tci-charlotte.com, and fill out our new converts tab. Also, if you've decided you want to connect to TCI, you want to become a cyber member, go to our website, tci-charlotte.com, and click on the membership tab and fill that out, and we'll get in contact with you and let you know what information we have in store for you to help you to become acclimated as a new member of the body of Christ or as a new member of the TCI family. Let's thank God for those who are giving their lives to Christ even now. In Jesus' mighty name. We're going to now share in the holy meal. If you have not received bread and wine, please, ma'am, please, sir, raise your hand that we can get that to you. Hallelujah. And while we're preparing, I want you to also prepare your heart to give. Every time we come to the table of the Lord, every time we eat and drink the body and the blood of Jesus, the bread and the wine, it reminds us of the supreme sacrifice that Jesus made. The Bible says in John 3:16, I never tire of saying it, that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. God gave his only son. And in giving his son gave his life. And he did so for us. And you can never come to the table without being reminded about the principle of giving and the benefit and the byproduct of the same. God gave Jesus so that he could win humanity back. Jesus gave his life that we might have a right to the tree of life. Never come to this table, never come to this moment without understanding the principle of giving. And what happens when you give? That there's always a return. That there's always a harvest. So today I want us to eat and drink together. Father, I'm asking you to bless the bread, bless the wine. Let these sacraments be, these elements be spiritual food to our spirit man, that we might ultimately be reminded of the gift of new life and the responsibility that we have to live our lives on your behalf. So in the name of Jesus, we pray. Let's take the bread. Know the night he was betrayed, he took the bread. He blessed it, he broke it, and he gave it and said, "This is my body that is given for you. Take ye and eat all of it." And after the like manner, he took the cup, said, "This is my blood for the remission of the sins of many. Take ye and drink all of it. For as often as you eat of this bread and drink of this cup, you do show the Lord's death until he come." Again, if my brother, my sister, if you need an envelope to give an offering, will you please lift your hands? Is there one? Is there anyone who needs an envelope to do so? We have 2, 3 envelopes over here. Anyone else? 4. 1 in the back. Hallelujah. There are ways that you can give, and you let me just go over these ways briefly, very quickly. You can give online. You can go to our website, tci-charlotte.com. Take your bank card, your credit card, your debit card. You can text to give by texting the word give, that's G-I-V-E, to 336-891-4023. You can cash app to give by sending your gift to our $ church favorite cash app. You can also, if you sow first fruit, you can do that as well on $ church favor. If you give it to the building fund, you can go to our website, tci-charlotte.com, or we have a cash app designated specifically for our building fund, $ TCI building fund. But be found giving, my brother, my sister, your tithe, 10% of your income is holy. It belongs to the Lord. Your offering is a free will gift by virtue of the fact that it's an offering. It is sacrificial. So we encourage you to give bountifully, for the Lord loves a cheerful and bountiful giver. A few things by way of announcement. We're going to get out of here. Our evangelism ministry, they are hosting a bake sale next Sunday immediately after service. All baked goods are $3, and all the proceeds will go towards their annual outreach event. And so we want you, please, ma'am, please, sir, to support evangelism in their bake sale. Some good old banana pudding and pound cake and cobbler and sweet tater pie, whatever they're making. I'm a witness to these things that I've seen. It's all good. Also our Christian education and discipleship ministry in our series of classes is offering next evangelism for the believer. Let's thank God for our Christian education ministry. And you don't want to miss this. Evangelism for the believer. It's
is evangelism made plain. Instructors will be yours truly, and my good friend and brother, Bishop Jim Logan of the Kingdom Fellowship Christian Center. You talk about a genius when it comes to evangelism, urban evangelism in particular. This man of God knows how to do it. So we want you to register. And May 16, 2330 through June 6. So you can register now. Somebody say now. We can register now. And I was so pleased at the number of people who registered, but I need to see more. All of us need to learn how to evangelize. And so we want you to be on. All right. If you filled out your envelope, you're ready to give, will you please, ma'am, please, sir? Where you have your envelope? Everybody wave your envelope because we want to make sure we pick it up. All right. Let's stand because after we give, we leave it. Because of what the Lord has done for us. Father, we thank you today for the gift and we thank you for the giver. We honor you because we know, God, that you watch over your word to perform it. You're not to be mocked. Whatever we sow, that shall we also reap. And so today, God, we thank you that your people are blessed even now, that the seed leaves their hand, but it does not leave their lives. We speak 30, 60, 100-fold blessings over them. We declare, God, debt cancellation. We declare, God, financial freedom. We declare, God, that royalties will be released. God, we declare in the name of Jesus that settlements, God, will be received. We declare that inheritances will manifest and will be given to your children. And we declare that even if your people did not come from money, money will come from them. In the name of Jesus. Now, Father, we leave this place in the tradition of the church, not giving a benediction, but simply, God, leaving fellowshipping, because the word has told us that when we wait, God, you will do just what you said. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Hug somebody and tell them, just wait. I just wanna pray forever.